It's true. Come on. See, the only reason why a Christian would be worried around this time because they haven't been busy.
That's right.
About their father's business.
That's right.
So it's like, you know, forgive me this moment, when, you know, for real. We won't look for it. I grew up with seven brothers, and my father was a very good punisher. Not for doing right, but for doing wrong.
Yeah.
So we messed up the house up until around 3 o'clock. Right? He came out at 3 o'clock. And we saw him. And we saw him from a distance. And them seven little black, eight little black boys cleaned that house like that. We walked through the door. But if there was a lapse in our mentality, we just kept playing. That was it.
Yeah.
He came in and went off with everybody.
Yeah.
Well, God is coming back.
Yes.
And he's going to catch the church when her draw is down anyhow.
Yeah.
Just make sure nobody hands in the underwear. He shall come like a thief. You're gonna see, God is like this. Let me tell you a story. God is able to stop time.
Yes, he is.
He's able to change everybody's mind at the same moment.
Yes, he can.
So the only way you're gonna be ready is to be ready.
Yes.
No man knows the day nor the hour.
No,
you just observe the signs of the time. But you're going to have to give an account for the light in the event that you meet him before he meets you. Deuteronomy chapter 8. Can we just read this so we need to give God some glory?
Yes.
Because God brought the children of Israel through the wilderness to prove a point to them. They were wild animals.
Yes, they were.
Come on.
Yes, they were.
They had no sense of God.
Yes.
I mean, you know, we were bad. You know, when we were sinners, we were bad. But these were bad. Tell me this song. Bad. Now watch this. See, you have to see this. They were not anywhere near safe. Christ was not crucified. These was human beings raw. The rawest of sinners, raw. I'm talking about, you have no idea. You know how you can complain? You know what I'm saying? God knew that these people were so bad that if they would complain, he would have to kill them.
Yeah.
That's how bad they were. You know? That's how bad when they complained, that's how bad they were. Let me give you a little tip before you fall asleep on me. Don't fall asleep. In the book of Revelation, when God starts judging the world, guess what they start doing? Complaining to God.
Yeah.
Think about it. I'm going to teach you a lesson. Right now, some of you, who didn't grow up in the forest?
Everybody.
Anybody here have a parent?
Yeah.
If you had a good parent, the moment you complain, you tasted salt.
Yeah,
you wasn't even chicken. Your parents, bam, right across your mouth, bam. You're not going to bring God's wrath to this house. The children of Israel, they would complain and God would start killing them. When the church is raptured, there is no sense of God. So when he starts judging and punishing them, they don't even repent. The Bible says that they turn and curse God. Can you imagine that? You know it's God judging you and you curse him out. You need to thank God for the life you have now. So God raises up the children of Israel and he does these great signs and wonders so that his fear might be in them. And as his fear is in them, they begin to learn to respect God. Though their heart's not right. Fear is motivating them. And that's one thing you want as a child, as a parent. You want to put fear in your children mixed with love.
Amen.
Because only love can cast out the fear.
Yes.
When the fear turns into torment.
Yes.
Come on, man. Perfect love casts out fear, for fear is torment. And so we're stuck in a place where God raised up the children of Israel as an example of what he does to people. And we have churches today that are ripe for the judgment of God. Let's do this. I got 13 minutes left. You know, you got Ananias and Sapphira. I think that's why they call it Sapphira. They sold property, lied to God, and God killed them. Because they lied. Right? Because they lied. And guess what everybody else says? I sold them for $350. Church, stop telling the truth. Once God has his way, he will line up. That's why God's not having his way in a lot of our lives, because you know he cannot successfully judge us. Because most of us will curse God, put a curse on our kids.
Yes, Lord.
Then our family members will never get saved. Because we never train them to fear God. We train them to curse authority. Muffin just shot somebody and the police want to arrest her. Don't arrest my baby.
Come on now. It's true.
And so with that kind of mentality against authority, how are you going to expect your children to respect God?
Exactly.
So God raised up the children of Israel, bring them through Egyptian bonds, bring them through hardship, so that they can learn that there is a God to respect. And the reason why I'm trying to say is because if we don't respect God, we will never be able to give our life to him.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank you, God.
It's
forgetting
this.
I was staring at my daughter. You know, she's getting old and she's six. And my son is 22. And my son was like fake boxing me. And my daughter would jump right in the middle.
Right now.
Hitting him.
Yeah.
And I looked at it, I'm like, something about love.
Yes.
Love is a defense.
Yes, it is.
But God wanted to destroy the world. There was this guy. He said, you know, that's my brother.
Yes, sir.
God's going to kill all of them. Jump right between God and you. Jesus started fighting God for you.
Yes.
Said, if you don't kill anybody, kill me.
Yes.
That's why he God said, this is my son who I'm well pleased for. He will let me kill him.
For you.
For you.
Yes.
But I won't keep him dead. I'll take his life and put it in you.
Yes.
What kind of God is this?
Yes.
And so you see, but through our pilgrimage, our time here on earth as Christians, we have to learn to use this life the right way.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Instead of waiting on our blessing.
Yeah. Do.
Do.
Bye.
Do.
Yeah.
Deuteronomy 8:1. I gotta get going.
Thank you.
Y'all here?
Yeah.
I got somebody real bold and said, I'm starting to live right. And you see, in abstaining from sin, let me say this much about sin. Abstaining from sin takes time.
Yes, it does.
But it will take place.
Yes.
You ever heard people get married, they fall out of love? You know, how are you going to fall out of love if love is of God?
Yes.
You need to admit, you know, just stop it. Stop lying and get your, we're going to fall in love with somebody else. If you fall out of love, how are you going to get love again?
All right now. Come on now.
Yes. Come on, the devil trying to trick people to get a little extra feel on the side.
That's what it is. That's what it is.
No, that's not dumb. What are you doing? You're born in sin, shaping iniquity.
Yes.
Right. You need to get God's love in you.
Yes.
I just don't feel it for her no more. I'm going to cut your hands off. You don't need to feel it for anybody.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not talking bad, but if you think I'm talking bad, just don't tell them I said it. Look at Islam. If you got enough money, you get like 16 wives.
Yeah.
Which to me, you know what that's saying? They're paying for extramarital sex.
That's what it is.
They got enough money to have sex with more than one woman.
That's what it is.
America will love that. But God made them male and female. Can I just give you a little history? God made one man for one woman.
That's what
he said. Now you know, don't think I'm a show with this thing. It was the woman that messed it up.
You
wasn't that one man's idea? Don't touch that down. I'll explain it. God had Adam. You know, Genesis, there was this other guy, he took two wives. Everybody told him to take two wives. Then Abraham comes up, he got a little half-sister, he married her. He was happy. But she couldn't get pregnant. So she said, won't you just take my maid? Abraham said, okay, I'll take her. Sarah threw that woman at Abraham.
He sure did. He
had little Isaac. Isaac had his wife. They died. They had twins. Then, you know, Jacob, you know, he wanted to marry Rachel. His father-in-law tricked him, gave him Leah. He said, I didn't want her. He said, I worked 7 years. Give me this one.
Yeah.
Then they had baby wars.
Yeah.
Then Leah said, take my maid. He said, all right. Then Rachel said, take my maid. All right. So it was never God's intention to have more than one wife.
Yes.
Even though society tries to make it right. I was talking to a missionary when I was in Paris, France, and they said, what is the hardest thing to do when you go to these African villages? He said, the hardest thing to do is to convince them they can only have one wife.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Which one of you, Hitler, if this was a men's meeting, it'd be easier. I'm moving right along. So you see, just because society accepts your lifestyle doesn't mean God ordained it.
That's right.
But God raised up the children of Israel as an example for us. Mm-hmm. How he would bring you through hardship so that you can enjoy fellowship.
Yes.
You know what a spoiled child is? Let me tell you what a spoiled child is, because some of you got the misconception of a spoiled child. A spoiled child is a child that stinks. When you got fish that you don't have in the refrigerator, it stinks. A spoiled child is not a child that has more than the next child. That doesn't make the child spoiled. That makes the child blessed. All of you want to be blessed. See, but you don't see, but when that child has a nasty, stank attitude, that child's spoiled. So we as believers, when we don't have the right attitude, when we don't get our way, we're stinky, spoiled children.
Yes.
You can't pay a bill, you start crying.
Come on now.
Give me a lot of bills, you won't be able to pay. To God, get that stink out of you. What you crying for? You're a child of God.
Yes,
greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But if you like contrary, I didn't see that contrary on that because most young. You see a privileged child. A really good privileged child shares. A good privileged child shares. A spoiled privileged child. It's green.
Yes.
It's like, oh, slap that kid upside. Look at that kid crying all over the place. It could have been lack of discipline on the parents' part.
Yes,
parents'
it is.
Part.
It is.
Has God been able to chastise you like he wanted to? Some of you been complaining. Got to get up in the morning, go to church. Too long. How come God is not chastising you for your complaint?
Yeah.
Why not? You gotta ask yourself. I believe it's in Hebrews. It said, the Lord chastens every son that he receives.
Yes.
And he said, if God is not chastising you, then you're a bastard. That means you didn't have a father.
Yeah.
So if God is not convicting you while you're complaining,
yeah,
who's your daddy?
Yeah.
Think about it. All of us should be hot in pursuit of a right life.
Yeah.
I'm not going to complain. I'm going right now. We get away with it.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's a lot of things I can really thank my father for, but one of them was the smack in the mouth.
Yeah.
It was like, it was as if we released hell in our house if we tried to complain.
Yeah.
I'm just being honest with you. I don't remember a lot. Two things I remember. We always blessed our food, and you were never allowed to complain.
Amen.
You had potato chips, you blessed it. Well, three things. We said our prayers before we went to sleep.
Yes.
God bless mommy, God bless daddy, God bless both families, everybody else. Amen.
That's right.
Wasn't saying we were all on our way to hell, but we had some discipline.
Yes, that's right.
You're saved on your way to heaven. Where's your discipline? I gotta read this because I gotta close. All the commandments which I command you this day shalt thou observe to do, that you may live and multiply, go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldst keep his commandments or not. If you're going through any kind of hard trial, trust me. God is not trying to hurt you.
Amen.
He's trying to prove to you whether or not you're going to stay with him or not. God can put you on the highest hill.
Yes, he can.
God can change every aspect of your life in a moment.
Yes.
But that doesn't count if you're a spoiled, rotten baby.
Yeah.
That will turn. You ever got married? Don't mention it. But if you ever decide to get married, you get married with the intentions that for better or for worse, we're in this together. We're in this together. We're in this together. I mean, it should have been, instead of Naomi and Ruth, it should have been Naomi and Rufus. It seems like women know how to cling to other women. Yeah, child, I'm with you. I'm with you. Yeah, where you go, I go. Where you live, I live. What about your old man? My old man. I see the boy married now. It's the truth. But in marriage, the two, they should make a covenant. I'm never going to leave you. I'm not going. You can kick me down the stairs, but I'm going to hold the rope to you. And you fall with me. If you kick me, you're going to break your neck too. That's the covenant God made with you. He said, I'll never leave you. I won't forsake you.